hope so, is ready to go.
Okay, so our first session for this morning is OurFuture2057. And, okay, so as the first question, could anyone tell me what is the significance of 2057? Okay, that was
too easy. Okay. Right. Can anybody suggest, you know, what do you think about 2057? You know? Yes, of course it's the future, but can you tell us a vision? You know, what you want Malaysia to be like in 2057? Anybody any ideas? Maybe in terms of education, maybe you know, women empowerment, the economy, maybe, yeah.
What I envision for Malaysia to be like we are now, but a better country with more free education for all, opportunities in job employment for all fresh graduates from local universities in Malaysia. So I see a progressing Malaysia that is building quality graduates that can work, and our education is recognized all over the world.
Alright, brilliant. What's your name, sir?
I'm Azeem from USA.
Yeah, brilliant. Free education. So, make it more accessible so that people, you know, more people can get education and improve their quality of life. Okay, any other suggestion? Yes, sir.
Hi, good morning everyone. My name is Karen from Soaring Upwards. I just hope the price of petrol will go down. No, on a more serious side, I hope that people from Harvard and MIT and Stanford will recognize institutions in Malaysia as equal to them or as of that Ivy League standard. And we attract a lot of students from the Middle East, from some parts of Eastern Europe now, Kazakhstan, Russia, you know, from Southeast Asia, but we don't attract Western Europe, we don't attract America or South America. We want to see that education hub being Malaysia being a global education hub, not just a regional one.
Right. Okay, yeah, brilliant. Basically what you're saying, you want the education institution to be world class, right? To attract people from all around the world, not just from, you know, Asian countries, but maybe the Western world, you know, maybe from America. And be at par with, you know, the rest of the world-class universities. Okay, thank you very much.
I wish for our country to have a better equality in terms of giving education not only to the able bodies, but to the disabled too, or the special needs. You know, sometimes the special needs are being pushed to Tibet just because they are not able like us.
Yeah.
Sometimes university doesn't want to provide special facilities to help them. But I don't want that. I want like the special needs, like boys with autism, or girls on wheelchairs, to have the opportunity to go into academics because they have something to offer. I mean, it's not only to technical, cooking and everything. They can all do well in academics because I see little number of students who are in special needs in university.
Right, I mean, what you mentioned actually really touched me because I do have a relative who's autistic, you know, and we do see that for somebody who has a family member who has that, you know, you would know that, you know, the person needs extra care, you know, needs extra help, but those who do not have may not realize that, you know. So it does mean a lot, you know, to me and maybe to those who do have family members who have, you know, disabilities.
Subject by subject, you know, so you had English class, then you had geography, and then you had biology. And who here found that pretty boring? Okay. Not a bad amount of people. Okay, and who thinks that studying in that way is the best way we could ever study? Okay, I agree. Okay, so at one, what we propose to have reform in maybe by 2057, maybe thereafter, is something called a multidisciplinary curriculum.
But I think multidisciplinary should also recognize other forms of intelligences, visual, spatial, what else, like kinesthetic, you know, body movements. People, I think, are good in their own very unique ways. And just because we may not be super smart on paper, on theories, on reading stuff, may not necessarily mean that the person is not going to be successful in life. Very good creative people out there, dancers, artists.
What we need, everybody to do, basically, is just to imagine what kind of case study we can use that has multiple subjects in it. So in this case, maybe a student can get involved in a project for strategic communications team, focusing around developing a politician. And the first thing usually in this exercise is you need to identify what is the problem that this politician is having. Okay, it could be so many things. Maybe if this politician is new, this politician may not have enough visibility on social media. Okay, so if the politician needs more visibility, that means you need to go online, right, and see how many mentions they have. You need to come up with statistics and to gauge if he's getting enough, visibility. So that's one, statistics. All right, that's the first thing that this student who will be doing this project will learn, statistics. Okay. And because in statistics, there's polling, okay? And of course, you need to know, if the politician is communicating well enough, if his the use of his English or BM language or even Tamil or Mandarin is correct. So now that's language, all right? So that's the first step that a student will need to do, which is identify a problem, all right?
Okay. So once you have identified the problem, or maybe it's not a problem, maybe it's just something that they want to improve about themselves. Okay, and Azeem said, we combine all those different subjects, and you can see that, some of them are not traditional academic subjects, which you guys mentioned. Okay, so once you diagnose the problem, what do you think is the second step to resolving this politician's image issue? Joshana?
You got it. What is it? Exactly, correct. You need to propose a solution in the form of a strategy. Question? Devising a strategy, which is a solution. Correct word. Correct. So, once you've identified a problem, what's the solution? You need to be, you need to understand the political circumstances around the client. Alright? So then you learn political science. Correct? Who's here, doing political science? Yeah, see? So now you need to be, seeing what's the demographic like in the constituency that this politician is trying to compete in, correct? So he will need to see, whether the voters, what kind of issues that the voters, care about. Do you want their drain fixed, their roads, their surau to be built or their dewan to be built, right? These are all. Things that you need to think about as part of political science, perhaps. But can you share with us, what you learn in political science, other than that?
Because in political science, what matters is about the foundation, how we want to build a politician that not only what we call it as berjanji manis, but also how we want to build a politician that can solve the problem itself. And what's matter is because in IIUM we have the political thought subject. Yes, maybe we say would think that why we need to study this subject, political thought, about Aristotle and also the Islamic scholars. Why? Because it creates our foundation as a politician. And if you want to change something, you have to build a strong foundation in order to build something greater for the nation and also for the people.
Yep, absolutely right. Okay, so you need to build, the foundation, the character, the kind of policies that he has in mind to introduce to the public, then promote it, right? Okay, next.
Okay, so the third stage, I'm not going to get you guys to guess, but the third stage is about executing your strategy. And if you can see there are actually, in red, quite a lot of non-traditional academic subjects. So, you can't go to school and learn people skills. I mean, you're not going to sit in a class and a teacher is not going to stand at the front and say, "Hi, I'm here today to teach people skills." But You see, that's why you see, if you have a multidisciplinary session like this, right, you will automatically begin to develop those skills because you are applying them in a practical context. And I mean, that's really important, right? Like when you go and work later on, or you know, when you, I don't know, you maybe even you study even further, but you're always having to deal with people. So it's better that you start early when you're at school and then develop those as you go along. Now, as Azeem also mentioned just now, there are time management skills, organizational skills, crisis management skills. So these are all things that you would develop in a multidisciplinary session. Now, when in our little fictional scenario here, if you have a, let's say you're executing your strategy, what do you think that you would do as a communication specialist when executing?
Yeah. So during campaign, I mean, for example, what do you do?
Would you just run around like a headless chicken?
No.
Any ideas? What do you do during campaign? I mean, have you seen campaign, you know, what do you do? You know, you saw Donald Trump campaign?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what do you see they did? Yes, debating. Hello? Other than that? Social media messaging. Brilliant. What else? Sorry? Yeah, addressing controversial issues. Yeah. What else? Publicity. Correct. Yeah. And so you learn all these things, right? And then you learn policies, then you learn law, right? And then maybe, you know, you have to deal with the environmentalists, you know, who may not be happy with you, the politician wanting to build a factory for more jobs. And when you learn environment, then there's a bit of science there. All right? So these are the things that you learn. All right, what's next, Anna?
Okay, so the fourth is impact assessment or monitoring. So this is, in a way, during the actual campaign and also maybe after the campaign, because you need to see how successful you were, right? So then you'd go with, this is obviously maths, and I know not all of you here are accountants or mathematicians, but it's so important to be able to use technology, to be able to understand polling numbers if you're going to be a communications executive, especially if you're going to be one that helps politicians out. So maybe that's given you a bit of an idea about what a multidisciplinary session is. This is very, very real. I mean, all of us know like GE is coming up. So definitely a lot of people are going to be following this formula or something along these lines. Well, I hope they will anyway. So your challenge today is to come up with your own multidisciplinary session. And before you guys all get really worried and, you know, first of all, it's not competitive. It's not the actual pitching competition. It's just to get your innovative and creative juices flowing. So we're going to split you guys into teams. You're going to stay in your uni teams, but you're going to be grouped in each group is going to have six uni teams. You're going to have facilitators for each group, and we're going to provide you with all sorts of colorful pens and paper so you can, you know, your inner artist can come out. So if all the fassies want to stand up and show yourselves, yeah, these are all the lovely people who are going to be helping you today. I've listed down all your unis here. By the way, so you will be coming up with your multidisciplinary ideas in each team, so in each team of three, and then you'll be presenting your ideas at the end to your facilitators. Yeah, so it's not a competition. But it's just a way to get you guys going for the day. Your facilitators will give you the timing, but probably you'll have about 45 minutes to come up with your ideas, yeah?
Yeah,
and then please come forward. And you might want to present for 5 to 7 minutes. Yeah?
Okay.
Right, group two, Keishan. Gary?
Okay, so we've got plenty of color pencils, plenty of paper, more paper coming in. And I think what you want to do is, how do you see the Malaysian education in 2057? Alright? And you want to think about it in a design thinking, I mean, you know, in that process of point of view. So, what is the problem? How do you identify the problem? How do you devise a solution for that problem? And also, how do you monitor and assess what you have done? All right, so it's basically like what Hannah and Azeem talked about just now. And what we wanted is not so much, you know, what you guys, that nitty-gritty of the details. We don't want to know what hashtag you're going to use to, you know, improve Malaysian education. So you've got 45 minutes to discuss and all that, and then you're given about 5 minutes to just do a presentation. And I think this is a great way just to warm up also for the evening, because you're going to be presenting also to the judges.
And you just basically have to say, look, you know, this is the problem, and what subjects do I need to use in order to solve this problem? Yeah? I'll come back in a couple of minutes to see how you guys
are doing. Singer also. Singer also.
Yes.
Sebab masih di tengah masak kan? Oh, bila lagi.
And then at least we have a lot of ideas. To have a great idea is to have a lot of ideas. All right, so everybody can work on different stuff and then, you know, can be inspired by one another. So the key thing is have fun with it. All right, and you never know, you know, you come up with a really cool concept that, hey, maybe you want to try it out in real life. Okay, let's go.
I want three suggestions.
Okay.
My eyes.
This is how you can, when you get a student to do maybe a cafe business, these are things that they will learn. So what we want you to do is just to draw it like we did, almost like we did, on your maybe cafe business. You know? But it can be anything. It doesn't have to be cafe business. It can be something else. But it has to be real world.
Ini mungkin kita boleh tengok ROI, return of investment.
Mungkin material.
Hi guys. Hi. You guys come up with your ideas?
Yeah. We are playing currently.
Very good morning for everyone. We are representative from UMK Jeli Campus. It's in Kelantan. Yeah, Jeli. So we actually want to bring out what is most important to our university, which is the faculty of agro-based industry. Okay, so it's called FIAT in short. So what people don't realize is, right, the stigmatization nowadays is that farmers are just farmers. People don't take farmers as professionals, or people don't take farmers as important individuals to the country or to us, because they don't realize that farmers are the ones that provide food to us. Farmers are the ones that provide food security to our country and everything that we need to eat. Alright, people always think that, okay, the most important people are doctors, lawyers and engineers. These are the kind of stigmatization that we have in our society nowadays. But people don't realize that farmers are actually important as well. So firstly first, without knowing, farmers are actually very multidisciplinary individuals, right? Firstly, they are entrepreneurs themselves. So why do I say entrepreneur themselves? Because they need to know the fundamentals of being a business person. It means like they need to know how to sell their products. They need to know how to market their products. So they need to understand what is most important to customers. What do customers want in the end of the day? They need to know. They need to satisfy the customer needs. So they need to have fundamentals of being an entrepreneur. They need to communicate with the customers to know what kind of products or what kind of vegetables, what kind of fruits they are looking for. So secondly, they need to know how to sell their products, right? If you have your products but you don't know where to sell it, there's no point to it, because in the end of the day, your crops will just rot. So they will need to know where they need to sell their products. Who should they target? Should they be targeting like companies? Should they be targeting hypermarkets? Should they be targeting at markets, people at the markets selling vegetable at the markets? They need to know who they're supposed to sell their products to. And thirdly, they need to know how to market this thing. When you find your target market, that's one thing. But how do you actually sell? How do you market your products? Like, you have to have a proper packaging. You need to have like a proper hygienic requirements, practices. You need to read whether it's halal regulations or not, since we're in Malaysia country, right? So being an entrepreneur is very important to a farmer, all right? Secondly, is on the management skills, all right? Because being a farmer, you need to manage a lot of things. Like, managing a big farm is not easy, right? It's not like just like, you know, mine siram air, or you just like watering your plants outside your gardens and things like that. Like, pests grow, you need to know what kind of proper like insecticides to use and things like that, right? So you need to have a proper management skills. And you will have workers working for you, right? So you need to communicate with your workers. You need to tell them what to do, or how to harvest your crops, how to plant them, how to water them, and things like that. Secondly, they need to have problem solving skills. When there are problems such as diseases or worms growing and things like that, they need to know, like climate change, they need to know what to do to their farm. They need to know how they should solve this issue.
For your experience, right? So, and then if you're a fresh grad with no experience, what they're looking for is actually your achievement. What have you achieved? What have you done? Right? So the great universities you see out there, Ivy Leagues that was mentioned, stuff like that, that's their main focus, is that how is it that what you do here in the university contributes to the human society? You know, how do you contribute to the humanity, which I contribute? How do you make change?
Because what's the use of paper if you can't execute it in real life? And this project-based execution will test their soft skills, communication skills, because they will need to work in teams, right? So you have a team of, say, 5 in a certain area. Because we live in different parts of the world, this, for how we see it, well, it's realistic only in certain areas. So, for example, we all live in Klang Valley, right? So, and the team is formed from people within the same area. So you group people up, little small ecosystems, and they work within the ecosystems to create these projects. And the monitoring part is how successful these projects are. And it's assessed either by proper deliverables, you know, feedback from people who experience these projects, certain educators who actually assess them. They could even be assessed by the little robot friends who gives them feedback and improvement.
So basically, the problem during our primary level of the learning, so that we, our system of the government more focusing on the exam base, where exam orientation, and without more practical thing and stuff, and then there is too much pressure during the learning process. So that one of the subject, no combination of the one subject, so it makes it no funny learning, which is made solely for math, science is solely for science. Then there is no add up of any things outside of the classroom.
Okay. Kami akan bentangkan mengenai macam mana nak dapatkan budaya tentera ke dalam masyarakat. Jadi, siapa tahu, siapa sedar dan siapa yang jangka 1941 Pearl Harbor akan diserang. Jadi masyarakat pada waktu sungguh tak bersedia. So kita Malaysia tak bila-bila masa boleh diserang. Jadi masyarakat perlu ada contribution, perlu ada sumbangan dalam nak maintain harmony, peace dekat dalam negara kita. Bukan hanya serahkan tugas semata-mata pada askar. Okay. So jadi kat sini kami highlight kan apa yang ada perlu ada pada seorang pegawai tentera daripada IPT. Jadi kita highlight IPT sebab mahasiswa dalam IPT dan mahasiswa boleh mencontohi pegawai tentera dalam IPT. So dari UPNM ada dua jenis pelajar, iaitu tentera kadet, pegawai kadet dan pelajar awam. Jadi pelajar awam ni basically akan banyak contoh he influence akan banyak terpengaruh dengan budaya-budaya baik daripada Askram.
So one chef at Satu, you have to execute it. So one of it is to have an education, to attend an education expo to promote your business. Second will be social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, publicity, celebrities. You guys, have you guys watched Captain America, the first Avenger?
Yes.
Have you guys watched the poster beneath you? Yeah, something like that. Design something, shoot some design, something like that. Top class facilities for the kindergarten, and as well as employees benefit.
We see the government of the perspective of the government of the new generation. I mean, the next government may be about the 2057, the government of 2057. So, what they want to educate and approach the youngster to build the cultural element. So, the problem is the youngster at that time is more interested in the technology than the cultural, such as interest for social media, online games, and others. Even now in 2000,
I always judge him, and that's the one reason that's stopping him from giving his opinion. Because what? Okay, why we want hot so much is because we want them to actually get their thinking juices flowing, and so. So that's why I feel like the main challenge is the fear of judgment. Okay, so what's the possible solution to curb this issue is the, we need a self-belief. I mean, this person needs a self-belief when he gives an opinion. For example, he knows what is it. I mean, he has the knowledge about it, but it's just that his lack of this self-belief that he can do it. So this self-belief is one of the possible solutions that he should adopt.
Ramai orang boleh buat practical skill, tapi bila bab-bab multimedia skill, entrepreneur skill ni kurang. So kat sini kita memperkenalkan sistem 211. Kat mana kita nak buat benda ni? Saya bagi contoh mudah, saya memilih Unimap sendiri sebab saya belajar Unimap mengenai practical skill. Saya nak buat rumah, so saya belajar practical skill. Tu 2 tahun practical skill saya belajar macam mana nak buat rumah, apa yang diperlukan untuk buat rumah, apa yang saya nak skill untuk saya buat rumah. Dan bila saya dah ada practical skill ni, saya nak hebatkan lagi diri saya. Saya tak nak upah orang untuk buat produk multimedia. So saya buat sendiri, belajar poster setahun saya belajar multimedia skill. Dan saya rasa saya nak buat bisnes sendiri. Saya tak nak kerja dengan orang lain. Saya setahun saya belajar entrepreneur skill. Dan akhirnya saya menjadi seorang job creator. Mana? Okey tak?
Ini masuk balik. Selamat
pagi. Okey, seperti yang anda tahu, cermin mata sekarang sangat banyak.
Cermin
mata sekarang berbagai jenis. Kualiti, dan kita sebagai pengguna cermin mata sering bimbang dengan harga yang ditawarkan.
Betul.
Namanya bagi cermin mata yang berkualiti tinggi.
Each group are you looking at?
It's between maybe 25 above.
One tip, in future you will be doing a lot of these pitches. Be very specific with what you say. Okay? For example, we're targeting working adults, people who are just going into the market. Specifically, we are looking for people from 25 to, because you said 25 and above, means my grandfather also can still buy this. Maybe he's a young adult also lah. But you know, I'm just saying, maybe you say 25 to 40, then people know exactly.
Okay, and everything, and access facilities such as community, schools, hospitals, centers.
If you're already done, please bring your mother access, to the front.
To, you know, various things. And
right.
Then, importance of those, and we need also to know importance of those seat facilities. So how do we determine all this problem? First, we need a research method. We need research method to determine what are the problems. Next, need assessment. Need assessment actually falls under social policy and community work courses. And then social policy, because in rural areas, you know, we actually in Malaysia we got all the social policies that help the urban people. But what about in rural areas? So we need to apply those.
Funding banyak. Then knowledge untuk IT pula, teknologi. Ini adalah antara satu-satu kemudian kita nak collect ataupun kumpul data-data kan, data-data kita punya customer, kita punya
orang ramai sekarang guna teknologi. So macam mana kita nak promote the best way lah? Orang mesti tengok through Instagram. So we have to have knowledge tentang
dan juga platform dengan medium untuk kita deliverkan kita punya produk.
Takkanlah kita ni orang kampung buat kerobolekoh tapi we don't have the knowledge pasal teknologi. So tak pergi mana lah sampai tu. It's very limited. So we have to go beyond that and technology
take up this role themselves. So once the program is there, pilot it together with the locals. Locals are able to initiate this thing and continue the impact themselves, and thus they are able to sustain this project on their own. So once we step on one area, we move on to the other.
Yeah, and the new.
So it's like confidence. Okay, so how is the now?
Devising a strategy, we come up with the improvement. Okay, first kita improve dari segi skills, yang paling penting lah. And the first one is art of persuasion and art of communication skills.
So, dia memberikan penjelasan kepada kita macam mana kita nak manage kita punya kewangan, and dalam masa yang sama macam mana kita nak manage kewangan orang-orang lain. Macam tu. Dia bagi pendedahan. So, macam saya cakap tadi, bukan hanya management skill sahaja tetapi banyak skill yang kita perlu pelajari dan cara macam mana untuk kita atasi benda ni dengan cara, salah satu caranya adalah menjemput orang-orang yang berilmu pengetahuan untuk mengatasi masalah yang kita ada, iaitu untuk convince para pelajar kita di universiti.
Malay language, not Malay culture. Malay language is our identity. So, the strategy that we going to have for empowerment of Malay language, we is we our target audience is the kids, because the kids is the one, the future generation will shape the future of our nation, right? So, okay, we will first is we targeting the technologies, the apps, where in current parents prefer to have their kids like. To enjoy interactive apps in their iPad or maybe in the tablet.
I like that you're thinking from the mind of a teacher. I like how you're thinking inside the mind of a teacher. And I like how you're thinking a bit of how a student would feel. But now, when you move on to do something like this, how does a modern age student feel? How does a student feel in 2017? Meaning students, all students already have their phones, right? How can we implement that in modern times? That's one thing. Two, in terms of presentation, when you talked about strategy, you also talked about execution at the same time. That's good, that's good. But you need to organize it so that you don't go and repeat the points again. You know what I mean? So.
Right, so guys. Right, we've seen all your ideas, they are amazing, and which is why we are putting all of them here, you know. Maybe during tea break, they come over and see, you know, each other's ideas, you know. And of course, I would like to congratulate everybody for coming out with amazing ideas. This is exactly what we need, you know. The ministry is doing a program called Reimagining Education, and you know, sometimes we just have to look inwards, you know, amongst ourselves and discuss. We can really get good ideas, you know, because when minds come together, we can come up with fantastic things, like you did, you know. We did give you, you know, a guideline, but we see that there are so many other ideas which went beyond, you know, outside the box, right? Some come up with military idea, you know, kindergarten. Those are, you know, unique ideas which we were looking for. Okay, so congratulations on that. Once again. And I was saying,
I just want to reiterate that I was really so impressed and so inspired, because it gives us so much hope for the future of this wonderful country, that all you people are so innovative and so passionate. So thank you so much for participating and being so enthusiastic. Okay, now I think.
The thing is, after this, there will be tea break, okay, then there's a design thinking session. We'll give you about 15 minutes, but I just want to give you an update on the social media competition. It's going really well. You know, we've got tons of data, tons of posts from Instagram, Facebook and Twitter. Keep them coming, because we are recording all of them, and we will start to announce, you know, the scoreboard tonight, okay? We'll tell you who's leading, you know, and how much more you need to post in order to beat the other person. But I can tell you that almost everybody here, you know, have put a very competitive social media competition. I remember I've done it before, but never this competitive. Okay? Because yeah, of course there are iPads we want, right? Right. So that's about it. The group can carry on. Doesn't it?
Yeah.
You done? No. Right. So they are done. After this, let's have belas ini pergi ambil makanan lagi kejap. You know, because belas ini ada. Nak makan tak? So we going there. Okay, so in about 15 minutes, okay, ambil makanan, and then boleh makan sekali, tapi you can make your way downstairs. Sebab next session will be at lobby, okay? So, okay, next session is lobby lah, bukan kat sini. So, you can have your meal, kejap, in about 10 minutes, go down eh, 10 minutes. So, what time is it now?
10.42.
Okay, so about 10.55 dekat bawah eh, alright? There will be a design thinking session. This session is just to warm you up though. Because design thinking session is going to be quite intense. Alright? Are you guys warm up?
Yeah!
Are you guys warm up?
Yeah!
That's why I'm here. Okay, so lastly, boleh pergi ambil makanan dulu.